by the time that we figure out they have TCC, it's late in the course of disease. And often by the time that we diagnose it, about 15% will have local spread, often to the local lymph nodes, and 20% of dogs will have distant metastasis, often to the liver or the lungs. Welcome back to the vlog. Today's topic is all about bladder cancer in dogs. And we're going to be focusing on prevention, causes, and things that you can do to detect this cancer earlier in dogs. So today's tumor topic is called transitional cell carcinoma. And most people think about transitional cell carcinoma, they think about bladder tumors in dogs. We can see this cancer less commonly in kitties. It's an uncommon cancer in general, but we see it more commonly in dogs than cats. Even though we most commonly see it in the bladder, you can see it anywhere in the urinary tract system. So in the kidneys, the ureters, which carry the urine from the kidneys into the bladder, the bladder itself, and then the urethra, which carries the urine to the outside world, and in the male dog passes through the prostate. So you can technically see transitional cell carcinoma, or TCC, anywhere in the urinary tract system. But what I want to focus on this vlog, you know, often I cover symptoms or clinical signs and treatment and prognosis, but in this video, I want to cover the causes of the cancer because I wanted you to know about that. But I want you to know which breeds are at risk because there's definitely certain breeds that make up the majority or one third of the pure breeds that we see this cancer in. And I want to talk about screening and early detection and this new urine test that we can use as part of this early detection. Because unfortunately, this cancer is often found late in the course of disease, and I'd like to help find it earlier. So let's do it, let's break it down, let's go through it. Like I said, it's commonly found late in the course of disease. And one of the problems is the symptoms or the clinical signs. So what are the things that you will typically see with this, with dogs that have bladder cancer or TCC? The symptoms are often very similar to a urinary tract infection. So you might see blood in the urine. Your dog might be straining to urinate. When they go out to urinate, there's frequent small urinations. It might be confused with urinary incontinence, so they're dribbling urine, or they're just having abnormal urinations. It's not usually that they're going out and just squatting for a really long time. Again, it's usually more small, frequent urination. And often if you do a urine culture, they will often have a positive urine culture. So they often have secondary urinary tract infections, they're treated with antibiotics, and they get better. And then it doesn't completely go away because they have underlying cancer underneath. So it often just leads to the fact that by the time that we figure out they have TCC, it's late in the course of disease. And often by the time that we diagnose it, about 15% will have local spread, often to the local lymph nodes, and 20% of dogs will have distant metastasis, often to the liver or the lungs. At the time of death, we often will see that 50% of dogs will have metastasis. So it's a cancer that is aggressive both locally in the bladder and, you know, where it's growing, if it's in the prostate, so it'd be very invasive, but also can be highly metastatic as well. So as I say, there's going to be two battlefronts once we diagnose it. So on exam, the challenging part is once you bring your pet into the veterinarian is sometimes we can palpate that mass with a rectal exam. Sometimes maybe when we feel the abdomen, the belly, we may feel something, but in about 30 to 40% of cases, the physical exam is going to be completely normal. So that's going to be one of the very challenging parts. And so that is why these other screening tests are going to be really important, and knowing which breeds are at risk is also going to be really helpful for early detection. So another phrase that you might read when you're Googling, in addition to transitional cell carcinoma, is the phrase urothelial carcinoma, which again is just another sort of more broad term for this group of cancers of the lining of the urinary tract. And like I said, most of them are advanced at the time of disease. In general, 95% of cases occur in dogs that are 6 years or older. So if you have a three-year-old dog with the signs that I told you, straining to urinate, blood in the urine, you know, it's more likely going to be a urinary tract infection or urinary incontinence. But if your dog is 6 years or older, then as I say, my index of suspicion for bladder cancer or urothelial carcinoma is going to be much more likely. So there are 14 breeds that make up a third of all the purebred cases for this group of cancer, for these TCCs, these urothelial carcinomas. So I'm going to put up a graphic that is going to, and I'm going to leave it up so you can take a look and to see if your dog is on there or if your dog has some of that in them, because it is really important. The top breeds, the highest risk breeds, are Scotties, so Scottish Terriers, Shetland Sheepdogs, Beagles, Westies, Westland Highland White Terriers, and Wire Fox Terriers. So those are some of the top breeds. Again, there are 14 breeds that make up a third of all pure breed cases. Does that mean that I do not see this cancer in mixed breed dogs? No, I absolutely do. But again, if you have a pure breed dog, you want to be thinking about screening. If your dog is 6 years or older, again, we're going to be more concerned if they're having these signs, you know, that it is not just a urinary tract infection, and maybe we need to do additional diagnostics like ultrasound, like this BRAF mutation urine test, to make sure that they don't have underlying cancer as well. So what are some of the risk factors for these cancers, for transitional cell carcinoma, urothelial carcinoma? So we talked about breed, not the only risk factor. Some of the other ones that have been reported in studies, lawn insecticides and herbicides. So it might not just be what you're using on your lawn, could be at the park, could be what your neighbor is using. And studies have even talked about like what drifts over from your neighbor's lawn as well. So just something to think about. Some studies have shown that female dogs are more likely to have it. I still see this in male dogs as well, but again, female dogs are at increased risk. Some of the older flea dip products have been associated with this. So not the spot on products, but the older flea dip products. Cyclophosphamide, a chemotherapy drug that I use quite commonly for dogs with lymphoma, that has been associated with it as well. So I don't commonly see that, but again, has been reported. Overweight dogs. So there is concern that obesity, so in the fat, can hold on to chemicals that we're exposed to, and that may be one of the possible causes. So those are some of the things that have been associated with possible causes. One of the things that has been shown to potentially decrease transitional cell carcinoma, and this was in a study of Scotties, which is one of the breeds that I told you is at high risk, dogs that got more leafy green and orange veggies were less likely to have a decreased incidence of this cancer. In this study, carrots were the vegetable that was given most frequently. And they were given three times a week, seemed to have a good benefit. So that is something to think about as well. And I do always recommend giving your, you know, pet vegetables. So that's something to think about. Just as a little side note, no onions. And I know grapes and raisins are not vegetables, but just as a reminder, those can be deadly and toxic to our pets. So just avoid those as well. So what can we do? How do we prevent this cancer? So some of the things that have been suggested that I think are great ideas is limiting exposure to lawn chemicals. And maybe you can't control what's on the lawn at the parks that you go to. And I'm not saying don't take your pet to the park or what your neighbor is using, but you can control what you're using. So that might be something to consider. Limit exposure to the older flea products, the dip products, again, the spot-on products that you put on, you know, seem to be safe, and I use them in my own pets. Feed vegetables at least three times a week. Do we know that carrots need to be, you know, the magic vegetable? No, but that was the one in that retrospective study that was given. So again, I think it would be, you know, wise. There's other benefits of giving our pets vegetables as well. Know the high-risk breeds. We're going to show the graphic. Again, look at that graphic. Do you have a high-risk breed on there? Is your dog that high-risk age, greater than 6 years or older? Are they showing the symptoms that we talked about? Blood in the urine, frequent small urination, those signs of a urinary tract infection, that, and their, you know, high risk breed, age, those are things that you want to be concerned. So if they have these suspicious signs, high risk breed, high risk age, you want to do a workup early. Don't just start a course of antibiotics and see if the infection goes away, even if they have a positive culture. What is the best way to screen for this bladder cancer? So I'm going to tell you two approaches. A previous approach done by Dr. Knapp at Purdue, who has just been, you know, studying this cancer for years and really, in my opinion, like the guru for bladder cancer in dogs. And most of, you know, many of the studies, you know, will have her name on it. So Dr. Debbie Knapp out of Purdue, you know, she, for high-risk breeds, we'll do a urinary tract ultrasound and urine analysis and with a sediment where they look at the cells under the microscope at the lab every 6 months. And then if there's anything abnormal on there, they will do a scoping procedure and biopsy any suspicious lesions to really try to diagnose this cancer early. So early detection and early screening. Now there's a new urine test called the BRAF mutation test that I'm going to talk about in the next vlog, which is a very highly sensitive, really good urine test, non-invasive test. You can collect the urine at home, bring it to your veterinarian, and they can submit it. And that is a very good screening test that we can use to diagnose this cancer in conjunction with some of the other tests. So that is how I would recommend that we can prevent and screen for this cancer. Again, high-risk breeds, high-risk age, signs of a urinary tract infection. Please remember that dogs of other breeds are at risk as well, and your mixed breed dog can get this cancer as well. But again, I just want you to be aware of what the signs are so we can diagnose it earlier. It's a very treatable cancer. We'll talk about that as well in another video. It's a treatable cancer. I have many patients that go on and have a great quality of life with treatment, but I really believe early detection is going to be very important. So I hope you'll come back, watch me at the next vlog. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you found this video helpful. In addition to educating about treatment and prognosis, I think early detection is so important. Again, thanks for watching. I hope to see you back at the next video.